Once upon a time, there was a movie about Skid Row, a florist shop, a boy who loved a girl who loved a drill-happy dentist, and a plant, a very special plant. That small movie, made in 1960, became a cult classic, then a successful award-winning Broadway show, and now a major motion picture from Warner Brothers and producer David Geffen. This is the story of Little Shop of Horrors. It all began in this little shop, where, strange as it seems, something extraordinary happened.
Fred isn't feeling very well today.
No, he's
not. What kind of a random plot does that seem?
Little Shop of Horrors, a story about a boy.
I've given you sunlight, I've given you rain. Looks like you're not happy, unless I open a vein.
A girl. And a plant with a very strange taste in food. The original Little Shop of Horrors was the accidental creation of noted filmmaker Roger Corman.
How come you woke up? Blood?
The original Little Shop of Horrors began almost as a joke. I was having lunch with the studio manager of a small rental studio at which I had space in Hollywood, and he mentioned that they were finishing shooting on a film and had nothing coming in. And I knew what the sets were like, and I said, look, leave the sets up, and I'll see if I can't make something very inexpensively, and I will tailor something to the existing sets. And he said, fine, how long do you want them? I said, 2 days. And he said, you can't make a film in 2 days. I said, I just want to see if it can be done.
That ain't fair, Mr. Mushnick. You know what I'm doing? I'm working on a special surprise plant just for you. I'm growing a plant like you ain't never seen before.
Excellent. I can't even sell the plants I got in my shop. Out, you!
So I made the arrangement to utilize these existing sets for 2 days, and then I met with Chuck Griffith, who is a writer I had worked with successfully several times before, particularly on a comedy horror film called Bucket of Blood. And Chuck and I brainstormed for about 1 day, and eventually came up with the idea of the man-eating plant. And Chuck wrote the script, I think, in something like 2 weeks. And I made a deal with the actors for a one-week salary. And I rehearsed Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. And then I shot the picture on Thursday and Friday, plus a little second unit night footage afterwards, and the film was made.
From these humble beginnings began a chain of unqualified success. Little Shop of Horrors opened at an off-Broadway theater in New York, beginning a theatrical run continuing to this day. David Geffen was a driving force behind the original theatrical production.
A musical about a plant that eats people and sings, I couldn't imagine what it was. In truth, you know, the movie that it is based on is one of the famous jokes in Hollywood. It's a movie that was made in 2 days. And it was Jack Nicholson's first movie, and I had seen it. And it is famous because of how bad it is, finally. You know, so when someone said they can make a musical of this, I thought, sure. The worst idea I ever heard.
Geffen took this worst idea and turned it into one of the best ideas in show business history, as audiences worldwide have testified.
Kinky!
I thought it was really amazing.
Beautiful. It's a birthday present for my son. He's 12.
It spans the spectrum of all ages.
We liked it so much that we brought our whole family this time.
I liked it a whole lot.
Little Shop of Horrors is the greatest play in the universe.
It's better than Gremlins, better than E.T.
It was one of the most delightful and enjoyable plays I've seen in a very long time.
I saw the show Little Shop of Horrors off Broadway shortly after it opened, and I liked it very much. It's very funny, it's very fast, it's irreverent, it has the qualities of the original film, and it followed the basic line of the original film very well.
After the huge success of the show, Geffen, who has also produced Cats, decided to bring the magic and excitement of Little Shop of Horrors to the motion picture screen.
To be perfectly candid, when we started the whole project, we thought we'd make an inexpensive movie. In our minds, we were going to make this movie for no more than $6 million. Originally, Steven Spielberg was going to produce it. Marty Scorsese was going to direct it for me. $6 million, we were all going to go in, do it very cheaply. And of course, it never turned out to be what anybody expected it to be.
What it became is one of the most successful motion pictures of the year. To expand the modern version of Little Shop of Horrors to the scope of the big movie screen, Geffen gathered a top design team headed by Academy Award-winning designer Roy Walker and built a complete New York street on the studio sound stages. It took the craftsmen 3 months to turn the empty stages into an exact replica of Skid Row in Manhattan. Geffen also brought in some of the most talented special effects people in the industry, as well as finding some of the newest and most up-to-date technical equipment to be used in filming. And to bring Little Shop to cinematic life, he signed the incredibly talented director, Frank Oz.
I don't believe in opening up movies for the sake of opening up. I don't believe in taking a play like Little Shop of Horrors and saying, well, we're all inside this shop now, so it's time to get out. Let's have the characters sing this song like they're walking on the street, and then we can come back in. I don't believe that. I believe you have to, it has to feel right. And so what I did is I just hopefully allowed the characters out of that shop, because in the stage version, everything takes place in the shop or an extension of the shop, which is just outside the shop, kind of imaginary sidewalk. And of course, he couldn't do that in the movie. So what I did is I took it out of the shop, but only at those times where I felt the characters would naturally go out of the shop anyway. I think we got a pretty good compromise.
To create the role of Seymour, Geffen and Oz unanimously picked actor-comedian Rick Moranis, who had made a worldwide impact in Ghostbusters.
I started life as an orphan, child of the street, here on Skid Row. He took me in, gave me shelter, a bed, crust of bread, and a job. Treats me like dirt, calls me a slob, which I am. So I live. That's your home address, you live.
David Geffen called me and told me that he wanted me to do the show, and I think it might have been even before Frank was involved. And I went and met Frank after Frank got involved and said, you know, just because all these other guys want you to use me doesn't mean you should, Frank. You know, it's your picture, you got to decide. So we got along really well, and Frank decided that he agreed with David and wanted to use me in the role, and I was more than happy to do it because it's such an unusual role to be offered as an actor. The character gets to do so many different things. It's really a tremendous, tremendous role, tremendous opportunity.
All right, that's it. Forget it. Don't bother coming in tomorrow.
You don't mean
you can't.
What don't I mean? I'm through. Forget it. Kaput.
You can't.
Kaput. Extinct. I'm closing this garden. Customer forsaken place.
Mr. Mushnick, forgive me for saying so, sir, but has it ever occurred to you that maybe what the firm needs is to move in a new direction?
What Seymour's trying to say is, Seymour, why don't you run downstairs and bring up that strange and interesting new plant you've been working on?
Before we ever started the process, I had always wanted Rick Moranis for Seymour. I'd always thought that he was the perfect casting. In fact, I ran into him at a concert long before we began the picture, and I said, you're going to star in my movie. And he looked at me, and I'm sure he thought, Hollywood, you know? But he actually was the only person I'd ever considered.
And in a rare instance of logical movie casting, Ellen Green, who originated the role of Audrey on the Broadway and London stage, was signed to recreate her role on screen as well.
Frank called me up and I just screamed bloody murder. I was ecstatic. I originated it, but normally you don't get the film, and I knew that. But Frank let me fight for the film. Frank believed in me, David Geffen believed in me, and I had a wonderful time with Rick Moranis.
I mean that part, like
touch
that.
More.
Sure, sweetie.
It's a trippy little area, that's sure, all.
Sure. I'm told that it's probably the first time that the person who's originated the role has created into the film role. I don't know, I haven't looked into the history of it, but I don't remember that happening before. It was not the purpose of casting Ellen in that role. I just wanted to cast the best person for the role, you know, and David it is.
It's so hard to say, suddenly Seymour.
Suddenly Seymour.
you see her insides when she sings, and her hopes, her joys, her personal depth. Otherwise, you see the person that she is at work, and good morning, Mr. Mushnik. I mean, she's just open, real open, I fell in love with her like everyone else.
The studio, my financial partner, Warner Brothers Pictures, said, well, what about, you know, let's think about Barbara Streisand for Audrey. And Barbara Streisand is and would have been great, no doubt, if she were interested. But Ellen Green was perfect in the role. And it was hard to imagine anybody being better than Ellen Green, in my mind anyway. She was sort of a cross between Judy Holliday and Vivian Blaine.
There, now isn't that bizarre?
At least. What kind of a weirdo prat is that, Seymour?
I don't know. I think it's some kind of fly trap, but I haven't been able to identify it in any of my books. I gave it my own name, though. I call it an Audrey II.
After me?
I hope you don't mind.
The real kicker, the real thing that made it exciting for me was the three girls. Because the three girls add style to the picture. They're the ones who really allow you to make it a stylish movie. The plant and Audrey and Seymour and the wonderful music and Mushnik and all the characters are terrific. But without the girls, without the three girls, it would be a story. With the girls, it's a story with style.
Frank basically took us to dance classes just to get the feel of moving, not so much of dance steps, but just the feeling of moving our bodies. Because when I first auditioned, I auditioned with her, and she could really move like the girls in the 60s. And you have to learn how to move like that. And it was hard, kind of hard for me in the beginning.
What did she say?
One of the highlights of the original film and the stage version was the character of the sadistic dentist, which was quite tame compared to the outrageously funny treatment provided by Steve Martin in the modern movie version. Martin, one of America's top comedians for the past two decades, made the drill-happy dentist a character to remember.
The movie stands completely on its own as a total entertainment. And is made that much more entertaining by the fact that these people are great in it. And I mean, Steve Martin has never been better in his entire career than he is in Little Shop of Horrors.
When I was younger, just a bad little kid, my mama noticed funny things I did, like shooting puppies with a BB gun. I'd poison guppies, and when I was done, I'd find a pussycat bashing its head. That's when my mama said,
what did she say?
She said, my boy, I think someday you'll find a way to make your natural tendencies pay. You'll be a dentist. You have a talent for causing things.
In the original movie and in the stage version, the scenes with Seymour and the dentist were comic highlights. And in the modern version, it was the special relationship between Rick Moranis and Steve Martin that made things work.
Oh, your mouth's a mess, kid.
I had a lot of fun with Steve. Steve sounds a little cliche, but he's really a professional. You know, he's like a great, great guy to work with because he's meticulous and he's disciplined, and yet he's tremendously funny. I mean, I'd met him before once, and I was always a huge fan of his, and I thought he was a really funny guy, but I didn't realize how funny he was in person. He really has a bizarre, unique sense of humor. The things that he comes up with just on the set, it's the line that everyone wishes they had come up with. You know? He's very funny and a really nice guy, and I think he does a great job in this picture. The character he plays the characterization he does is tremendous.
Rip that little bugger right out of there, what do you say?
No, you said well, no.
Oh. No, let me...
It's always time for dental hygiene, Seymour.
And action.
plan. Action.
Anyone else like a go?
Cause I'm a dentist and a fixer. Say ah.
But there wouldn't be any horror in the little shop without a rapidly growing Audrey II. And to create the plant in all its stages, including lip-synced vocalizing, was the technical challenge for animatronics wizard Lyle Conway. By the time he was finished, he had gone through 15,000 handmade leaves, 2,000 feet of vine, and 11.5 miles of cable.
Well, I'd worked with Frank before on Dark Crystal and Muppet Caper, and he called me to see how I felt about designing the plant. We got together. I'd seen the play a couple times in New York and did some drawings and did some small sketches and maquettes, small sculpts of the plant. In designing the plant, we've kept in mind a combination of the best parts of mechanical and hand-operated movement. Some of it requires a performer in it, and other parts of it are operated mechanically. Well, there's seven sizes of the plant. This is the smallest one here. And we sort of approached this one from the standpoint of a merchandising concept within the film, something that would be sweet and appealing to Seymour, something that he'd want to take home and be nice to.
Conway's hardest challenge came as he created larger and larger versions of the plant, which still had to move with such realism that the plant would really seem alive, even to the plant's fellow actors.
The plant, I think, thanks mostly to Frank and to all the people working in that department, the plant has taken on the characteristics of a human. And I feel sometimes when I'm working with the plant that I'm working with a really ugly guy, you know, some weird guy with a green head and a big mouth and that's made of rubber. It's the kind of concentration involved in acting, and as the character treating him like a character makes me almost forget sometimes that it is an inanimate object because he's so animated at the time that I'm working with him. When the take is over, I just kind of go, oh, you got it, and I walk away and go and get a scone or something, but the plant just kind of, it hangs there because 50 guys go away and, you know, have a tea break. So sometimes in between takes I go over and talk to the plant, but it doesn't respond.
Well, I suppose the biggest technological breakthrough on the film is the mechanical vines. There's a lot more vine work in this one than the playhead. And we approached the Atomic Energy Institute to do research and development for us on a core that wouldn't bend out of shape. And they came up with a couple of alternatives which made it possible to make
about an 8-foot vine
that had very positive movement and control.
Soon as you like a Cadillac car, on a gas shot on jackpot. How about a date with Hedy Lamarr? You're gonna get it if you want it, baby. How would you like to be a big wheel? Dining out for every meal. I'm the plant, you make it all real. You're gonna get it. Hey, I'm your genie. I'm your friend. I'm your willing slave. Take a chance, feed me in. You know the kind of eats, the kind of red hot treats, the kind of sticky licky sweets I crave.
In many of the different phases that the plant is in, when I first start working with the plant, it's this big, and by the end, it's 15 feet tall, and there are 50 people operating it.
You don't know what you're talking. You got no idea. You don't know. You don't know what you're messing with. You got no idea. You don't know what you're looking at when you're looking here. You don't know what you're up against. No, no way, no how. You don't know what you're messing with, but I'm gonna tell you.
from outer space, and it looks like you've been had. I'm just a mean green brother from outer space, so get off my back, get off my face, cause I'm mean and green, and I am bad.
I think audiences are going to feel many different things through the course of the movie. What they feel at the end of the movie, I hope, is satisfaction with the whole experience. The movie, I think, this is before having seen it, takes the viewer through a lot of different feelings. There's a love story going on. There's a bit of a horror story going on. So I think hopefully you're going to feel a lot of different things as a member of the audience.
They're going to feel real good, better than they felt sitting in a theater watching a movie in a long, long time. I think people are going to see this movie many times.
I think it's a love story. I guess it's just a story of a boy, a girl, and a plant. That's really what it is.
From two-day wonder film to international stage success to modern motion picture success, Little Shop of Horrors.
You would be swell to get out of here. Bid the gutter farewell and get out of here. I'd move heaven and hell to get out of skin.
Singing plant, a daring hero, a sweet girl, a demented dentist. It's the most outrageous musical comedy in years. Little Shop of Horrors also stars Vincent Gardenia. Screenplay by Howard Ashman. Music by Alan Menken and lyrics by Howard Ashman.